Hey everyone, it's Bobby from Lyco Birds with another video in my Bird ID Through the Year series. And since we just did one on winter field birds, I thought a good follow-up topic would be the types of raptors that you see in similar habitats. So this is going to be winter raptors that you find sort of in open field habitats. First up is red-tailed hawk, and we talked about this one a little bit in my intro to raptors video, but these are your classic Buteo shape. So basically long wings, short tail, just your classic soaring hawk shape. One of the most reliable plumage traits for identifying red-tailed hawks in flight is the presence of dark patagial bars, which are these dark marks on the leading edge of the inner part of the wing. And these isolated bars are pretty distinctive, and you're not really going to see any other raptors in North America showing that. Another feature you often hear about is the belly band, which can definitely be a useful feature in flight and on perched birds, although you have to be a little bit careful because it's not completely diagnostic. Other species do show it, or sometimes have variations that can show it. But basically, belly band means this dark patch of streaking sort of in the middle of the bird, and then you have clean above and below it. And you can definitely see it pretty well on birds in flight as well. And there is quite a bit of variation in how dark and how filled in the belly band can be. So you see this one, it's not particularly dark, it's just kind of a moderate amount. But then if you look at a bird like this, look how heavy and dark this belly band is. And this bird would be a good example of one from the northern population, what you'll sometimes hear called the Abietacola subspecies. So you'll sometimes see birds more like this in the winter when those northern birds come down from, say, Canada. But then the eastern population is more on average something like this. They can be a little bit lighter than this. They can be maybe a little bit darker than this too, but this is a nice average example, I would say. And adult red-tailed hawks have a dark trailing edge to the wing, and they also have the red tail that gives it its name. And we will look at the juveniles in a second, but just quickly, let's review the adults. So you're looking for the dark patagial bar, the belly band, dark trailing edge to the wing, and also the reddish tail. And identifying the juveniles is not too hard. Largely, you're using the same field marks as the adults. So you can see the juveniles also have dark patagial bars. They also have dark belly bands. So you can use those field marks and should use those field marks to help on all red-tailed hawks. And then you want to look for a couple of things to differentiate the juveniles. So first of all, they have thin dark banding on a brown tail instead of the red on the adult. And they also do not have a well-defined dark trailing edge to the wing like the adults do. They also have lighter eyes, which if you're really close to the bird, that might help, but you definitely do have to be fairly close to the bird. And lastly, the juveniles often show these translucent panels in the outer part of the wing. They're kind of square, so that can help separate from the adults as well, but other species of Buteo show that as well, so don't rely on that as a differentiator for red-tailed hawk, but once you have identified it as red-tailed hawk, you can use that to help say that it's a juvenile. And that also depends on lighting a little bit, so if you're not seeing it, I wouldn't use it as a point towards adult. It's just if you're seeing it strongly, it's probably a good indication that it's a juvenile. Next up is rough-legged hawk, and like red-tailed hawk, these are also Buteos, but they're a little more slender, and they have longer wings and maybe just a little more tapered wings. And these are the only hawk in the Northeast and Mid-Atlantic that you expect to see light morph and dark morph birds. There are, of course, plenty of raptors with dark morphs out west, but generally in the east, you're not going to see those. Although there is some evidence now that the northern red tails that I was talking about also can come in dark morphs, but they're very rare. And all of the birds on the screen right now are examples of light morphs. And the plumage can be quite variable, but one of the typical forms you see is like this bird on the left. You can see it has a completely solid belly band, but then also square patches out here in the middle of the wing on the leading edge. And it does not show the dark markings that red tails do. And that is what you typically see for the juveniles and the females. And this perched bird on the right here is another example of that type of plumage. You can see this very dark, solid belly band. And it also has a pale head, which is typical of this form. And rough-legged hawks have pretty small bills as well. And the male plumage oftentimes has some of the dark markings moving up more into the upper chest and throat area, but you can still see it has the dark square here towards the wrist. And the tail pattern is superficially similar amongst all of the plumages, where broadly you kind of have a dark tip that's pretty wide, and then either no banding or thin dark banding. And typically it's the male plumages that are more often going to show the multiple dark bands in front of the large one. But you can also find examples of more typical female plumages showing that trait, so that's not set in stone either. So to summarize, mainly you're looking for nice long wings and a tail with a broad dark tip and whiter base. And then on the females and immatures, you want to see a nice solid belly band and then the squares at the wrist. And then the males, usually it's a little more consistently dark throughout the whole body and the chest area, but they also do show those squares too. And here are some examples of dark morph rough-legged hawks. And again, you can see the similar tail pattern. You have the broad dark tip with a whiter base. You can see that on this bird. And then this bird has the broad dark tip with multiple thinner dark bands, typical of males. And then on the dark morphs, this whole area in here is typically going to be completely dark. Although oftentimes you can see that it's a little bit darker at the area where you have the dark squares on the light morphs. So there's incredible variation within this species in terms of the plumage. So hopefully I'm not scaring you too much, but generally in the field, these aren't too hard to identify. Just as always, use caution and apply the field marks that I mentioned. And next we'll look at American Kestrel. And these are one of the more colorful raptors with their sort of blue and orange colors, especially the males are quite colorful compared to most raptors. They are also quite small. So they aren't like small songbird size, but really they are more of like what you would think of as medium songbird size. So maybe something like robin sized. And they are falcons, which means they have black eyes and also quite pointed wings. And as I mentioned, the plumage overall looks orange and blue, but a couple other features you can look at are the double dark marks that you can see on the face, and sometimes you hear them called sideburns. The males have a strongly two-toned appearance on the upper side with the strong orange and blue, whereas the females have more of this orange and black barred pattern on the upper side. On the underside, the males show dark spotting, and the females show sort of orange streaking. And in terms of behavior, kestrels will often perch on wires, and a lot of times when they are perched there, they will kind of bob their tails a little bit. And you'll also sometimes see them out in the middle of a field hovering and looking for prey down in the grass below. And hovering means that they are flapping, but they're staying in one spot. And a few other raptor species will also hover like that. Rough-legged hawks can do it, ospreys can do it, but typically if you see a really small raptor doing it out over a field, that's a clue that that's a kestrel. And then we have northern harrier, which is a very long-tailed and fairly long-winged raptor that likes to cruise low over fields. And these are not owls, but they have sort of an owl-like facial disc. You can see sort of that disc in the front of the face. And one of the most common field marks you'll hear for these is the white rump. And just be careful with how you're applying that, because there are other raptors that sometimes the feathers underneath can kind of get blown up on top, and that looks like a white rump. Or you could be looking at the white base of a tail, for example. So just be careful with how you're applying that. Male northern harriers are nicknamed gray ghosts, and they are largely white underneath with black in the wingtips, and then otherwise they have sort of a grayish color. And sometimes you'll see them with a little bit of brown barring on the underside as well. And the females are a lot more brown overall. They have brown streaking on the underside, and then the young ones look sort of like the females, but generally not showing any streaking, and oftentimes they show kind of a cinnamon color on the underside. But even though the plumages are a little bit different, I would say in the field, you don't really get them confused at all in terms of being able to identify it to species. Just the behavior of harriers is somewhat distinctive. And another species that often hangs out in the same habitat as northern harrier is short-eared owl. And this is one of the only species of owl that you realistically will see flying around when it's light enough for you to actually see them well. Usually they will come out close to dusk, usually right as the harriers are starting to settle in, but sometimes you get them overlapping a little bit, which can be a lot of fun to watch them flying around together. In terms of plumage, a lot of times you're looking at a relatively pale face with these sort of dark triangles around the pale eyes. They also have bold dark barring in the outer part of the wing. And the flight style is quite a bit different than northern harriers, actually. And they're a lot floppier, and it almost looks like the flap that you might expect from some older, low-budget movie with some sort of flying monster. And again, this is one of the few species of owl that you're gonna see flying around out in the open like that. And we'll wrap up with one other species of owl. This is snowy owl. And it's probably one of the most iconic bird species, so I think probably most of you already know what they look like. And in general, they are large and mostly white owls. You typically will see them sitting low, either on a fence post or in a field or something like that. And although most of them are mostly white, sometimes there are pretty dark ones as well, although you can still see it has an all-white face. And these are pretty rare as you get farther south, but they are somewhat regular. I would say most winters, a few are going to turn up pretty far south into, say, Pennsylvania, Delaware. And some winters, they actually have what's called eruptions, and there's a lot of them that move farther south. And in Pennsylvania, we look for these in farm fields typically, although they do show up in some pretty random habitats. Sometimes they show up and like shopping centers and stuff like that. And in more coastal areas, they often show up on beaches. And a good rule with snowy owls is to enjoy them from a distance. Usually you don't want to get too close and bother them. Doing that repeatedly and having multiple people doing that repeatedly really can stress the bird out and ultimately can lead to their death. And since everybody wants to find a snowy owl, just be careful that you don't actually misidentify a red-tailed hawk that has a plumage abnormality. There are a lot of red tails that have very white plumage. You can see this one is almost completely white except for the little bit of red on the tail. And then this one From the front looks extremely white, and on the back, mostly white, but still a little bit of brown. But certainly at a distance, something like this could give a first impression of a snowy owl. And I will wrap up there for this video, but we still have plenty of raptor topics to cover later on in the series. So if you found this helpful, please like and subscribe, and consider signing up for my email list at lycobirds.com/email. I send out a daily ID quiz, and anything else that we publish is also included in that. So I hope to see you there, and I hope to see you in my next video. Thanks for watching.